This week on Maker Update, a 3D printed wheelie machine, cheating at Jenga, lenses without glass, and speeding up your Arduino. Hello and welcome back to Maker Update, the show where we find all the cool projects that makers are making and share them with you so you can get inspired on your own projects. I'm Tyler Weingarter and I hope you're all doing great. We've got a jam-packed show for you, so let's get going with the project of the week. Every now and again, you just need to marvel at how far 3D printing has come along. And one of the latest touch points in that story of progress is the Pantheon Campo, a 3D printed electric mini bike that isn't just a showpiece for a workbench. This is a bike meant to be ridden, crashed, and thrashed. Okay, I lied a little bit. This bike is, well, a bike. But it's also a showpiece for Pantheon design and the high-speed 3D printer that they've designed. But the 3D printing of this motorcycle isn't just some cosmetic parts over a metal frame. Nearly every structural, stressed, and load-bearing member of this motorcycle is 3D printed. The frame, the swing arm, the front suspension, even the foot pegs are all printed from carbon-infused nylon. The motor is an electric hub motor in the rear wheel. There are a number of parts that are joined together using bolts and heat-set threaded inserts, but most of the structural pivot points are held together in the traditional fashion. Long bolts, thrust bearings, washers, grease, and plenty of thread locker. The number of non-3D printed parts on this motorcycle is a shockingly short list. The wheels, the motor, the fasteners, and the handlebars, as well as the control levers, and that's about it. And you get to see the engineering team at Pantheon really put this thing through its paces, taking it over some sweet jumps and crashing it a number of times. The metal brake levers needed to be replaced a number of times, but the only 3D printed part that failed was the foot peg, not because it snapped, but because it kept getting ground down over the course of multiple crashes. I know we're over a decade out from the first 3D printed car, but that was made by a highly specialized printer using very specialized printing techniques. And the Pantheon Campo is also made on a specialized printer, but one that's a lot closer to what you and I have on our workbenches. And it's really impressive to see what can be made on them today. More projects. Have you ever wanted to be better at Jenga? Of course, the failing action at Jenga is arguably the best part of the game, but you never want to be the person to do it. And what I learned from this project by Happy Mad Scientist is that there's what's called the impossible move in Jenga jargon. And that's when you knock out a block that's supporting the entire tower and allowing the entire mass to fall and settle without toppling. And he's out to design a tool that lets him pull this off with a lot more consistency. The trick to doing this is to overcome the static friction of the Jenga blocks almost immediately. And the easiest way to do that is through the use of an air piston, which can extend in the blink of an eye and with a decent amount of force. He built a small portable air piston powered by individual CO2 cartridges. And the speed with which this thing can push out Jenga blocks is startling. Of course, it's not going to make it any easier for you to place the Jenga block back on top of the tower, but the fact that it can still pull off these impossible moves is seriously impressive. Simone Yetch recently traveled to Egypt so she could speak at Maker Faire Cairo, and also so she could meet and build a project with her friend Dina Amin. Their creative journey began with a trip to the local thrift market, where they bought a few split-flap alarm clocks so they could take them apart and re-engineer them. While the parts were great to help them understand how these mechanisms work, nothing was quite right for what they wanted to build. Dina loves animation. Seriously, you should check out her channel about animating the parts that go into devices. And she loves tracking the moon phases. So that's why Simone wanted to create a split-flap moon clock for Dina. In the process, you get to see her build one of these mechanisms, and Simone also shares all of her files so you can print your own. And from Stockpot, we have a wonderful solution to a somewhat mundane problem, the death of the universal remote. He's going to create his own so he doesn't ever need to worry about a discontinued product ever again. Over the course of the video, you get to learn how he planned the interface his process for the custom PCB, and his decision to use through-hole components over surface mount. His remote also makes heavy use of Home Assistant, so he can use it not only to control his home entertainment, but also his smart home lights, environmental control, and a lot more. Time for some tips and tools from Luke Edwin. We have a 3D printed lens that creates pixel art. And in an ongoing theme from this episode, there's no part of this lens that isn't 3D printed. Instead, this is a very tight grid of 3D printed plastic that allows his camera sensor to capture light in a totally unique way. You do need to photograph your subjects at a very close distance. That's just another unique aspect of this lens. Jeremy Fielding has a video on the tools he's used to automate his workshop, from dust collection to tool automation. A big part of this video is understanding relays and what they do, but also understanding the power needs of the components you want to control. Jeremy's video offers a wonderful breakdown on how you can use low-power, controllable circuits to control high-power components. Check it out. And from Playduino, we have a tip on how to make your Arduino 50 times faster. Okay, that's a bit of a hyperbolic phrase, but this is all about getting an Arduino Uno to perform with razor-sharp timing. In other projects, this might call for using the millis function, but in this case, it actually calls for eliminating that function in the code. He also shows you how to use assembly code to pause for a number of clock cycles. This is a wild tutorial. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, we have a video on how to make a digital hourglass by Mirko Pavleski. This is a project spotlighted by DigiKey, and it's powered by an ESP8266 dev board, an OLED display, and a tilt switch. Not a fancy accelerometer, just a mechanical switch with a ball bearing and an electrical contact. This tutorial shows you how to create the enclosure, build the circuit, and program it to work. All right, and that is going to do it for this week's show. A reminder, as always, you can get more info about every single one of these projects by following the links down in the description. While you're there, leave us a comment, give us a thumbs up, and hit subscribe so you don't miss the next one. Huge thanks, as always, to DigiKey for making this show possible, and to you for watching. Take care. We'll see you soon.